thank you so much. I'm delighted to be with you today and to be able to talk about some of our experience and hopefully provide some inspiration, maybe aid and comfort to those who are looking to apply these tools yourselves. I start with this kind of funky transition just to show that I look like PC, but I'm really a Mac, okay? My agenda for today is first to tell you a little bit about our social media experience, and by our, I mean mine personally, how I, as a 48-year-old guy, got involved in this. Well, I'm 48 now. I was in my early 40s. Then talk about Mayo Clinic's journey and some of those implications that it may have for you. I fundamentally want to talk about why it's not optional for you to be involved in social media, because social media is coming at you whether you like it or not. But on the positive side, I hope to inspire you to look at how these tools can help you do your work better and can help you serve patients more effectively. Our Mayo Clinic Center for Social Media was founded a little over a year ago, and it was the culmination of about 4 or 5 years of what we'd been doing at Mayo Clinic. But it was a great story because our CEO saw what we'd been doing with the PR and marketing uses of social media and said, it's got to be beyond that. I mean, these tools are really powerful. How can we use them to connect within the organization? How can they support education, research, clinical practice, and administration? And how can they just help us be more effective in doing our work? But the other part that I think is even more exciting to me is his, and our Mayo Clinic leadership's willingness to reach out and to say, these tools are so important, they need to be adopted everywhere, and that's how we can really accomplish what can be achieved. We do have an advisory board that represents people from across the healthcare sector, and Hugh Stevens, as was mentioned earlier, is one of our members. He's representing Australia, so all your hopes and dreams are on Hugh, and also as an international medical student. And then, the board is there to help us decide how to move forward and to react to some of the ideas that we have. We also have a group called the Social Media Health Network, and that's our means of reaching out formally to other organizations that want to use social media and to learn from us, and we're learning together. The Australian Private Hospital Association is one of those members. So this is a partial list of the members. But we're interested. We have something like 90 members now, 90 plus, almost 100. And our goal is that we want to be accessible and not feeling like we know everything, I mean, because it's certainly not the case. We want to learn from others' examples and diffuse knowledge throughout the healthcare system. One of my heroes who's influenced me a lot in my life is Guy Kawasaki. He helped launch the Macintosh in 1984 with Steve Jobs. And he's now a Silicon Valley venture capitalist. He has a great blog called How to Change the World. He has also a rule for PowerPoints that he calls the 10, 20, 30 rule of PowerPoints. No more than 10 slides, no more than 20 minutes in a presentation, and no smaller than a 30-point font. I just want you to know I'll be violating all those rules today. never fear. This is a health advisory that I generally put in my presentations. If any of you have epilepsy or another seizure-related disorder, it may seem like I'm using strobe lights, but the reality is this is not using strobe lights. I do want you also, though, to look. You'll note that if you were to click Lee Aase, click this link, and go to my blog, which is called Social Media University Global. Hopefully this will load. Yeah, so you'll see that all the slides are here. So please don't feel any need to take furious notes or anything, because all the slides are there. You can expand this to full size. And so just kind of sit back and listen and see what thoughts are inspired. Now I want to introduce you to a couple more heroes besides Guy Kawasaki. Six words that they taught me are actually, I can't say that they taught me, but they really enforced in my life. And four reasons why, if they're true for me, they're probably true for you. And those heroes are my mom and dad, Lewis and LaVon Aase. So that's my dad. He's 80. And I guess I didn't need to point out which one was my dad. But dad's 80, and he's on Facebook. Okay, so that isn't why he's my hero, but it does kind of tend to show that the demographics are expanding with this. But 40 or so years ago, as we were driving down the highways and byways of southern Minnesota, Dad and Mom would kind of play mind games with me. You know, they'd see somebody driving a piece of heavy equipment, running a jackhammer or something like that, and they'd say, "Hey, Lee, look at that guy. Look what he's doing." And I know now that they would look at each other with sort of a knowing grin, because they knew within just a few seconds they'd hear piping up from the backseat, "Well, but I can do that." And what I just want to say is, you know, I don't remember actually saying that, but I do remember them saying, "Well, probably you can." You know, that they, it's not like they taught me these words, but they were really encouraging about that. And what I hope to inspire in you is an "I'll bet I can do that" spirit when it comes to you using social media. And I want to give you four reasons why, if I can use these tools, you guys can use these tools. And the first of those reasons is, this is my fourth grade report card, okay, from Mrs. Jones. And as you see at the top, it says, "Lee's work has been average this period in all areas." If any of you have listened to a Prairie Home Companion, which is Minnesota Public Radio, the, you know, Lake Wobegon, where everybody is above average, this was before that time. I was average. And as you look at the bottom, it gets a little worse. "Lee has difficulty keeping track of his papers. Occasionally, he's late handing in assigned work. When we clean his desk, it's amazing what we find." So, but yet, my mom and dad still said, were encouraging. When I said, "I'll bet I can do that," I gave them ample reason to disbelieve, but they still believed in me. So I did move on to marry well beyond my station. This is my wife, Lisa, almost 27 years ago. She'll come into the story here in a little bit. But this next slide, the second reason. So I was mediocre in elementary school. The top line is my highest degree of educational attainment. And I have that for a couple reasons. First, because BS and political science just go together. But secondly, because in almost any room like this, I'm going to be among the least educated person in the room. Okay? I mean, lots more people here have advanced degrees, and the point is, you don't have to have that kind of advanced education. It really just takes common sense, it takes, you know, ingenuity, it takes just a willingness to try, and I hope that you'll do that. The rest of this slide talks a bit about my history at Mayo Clinic and the continuity between what I'm doing now and what I was hired to do originally. This isn't some wild new thing that you just do for its own sake. It's something that these tools help you do your job better. My job was to tell stories about Mayo Clinic, about our research, to help spread the word throughout through traditional media at first, and then also patient stories with appropriate consent forms signed, privacy releases. And this is just a continuity. Our story of how we got into this was very much in keeping with that. So I was mediocre in elementary school. I'm not that highly educated, and I'm a grandpa. Okay, this is my granddaughter, Evelyn. And we've got a little interesting story about her and how she helped me to see the power of social media. When her mom, my daughter, was at University of Wisconsin-La Crosse in 2005, there was a young man there by the name of Kyle Borg who went on Facebook and he put in the search term theology. And his for some reason, my daughter's name came up right at the top of the list. I think it might have been the alphabetical order thing. You know, Aase, her name was the same as mine. But I think it's more her picture than being the number one search result that caused him to poke her on Facebook. And he poked her and she messaged back. They talked for about 3 weeks. And then finally they met one Saturday afternoon for coffee. And 4 hours later, when Lisa, my wife, and I were out for a date, Lisa got a phone call and she talked with Rachel for about a half an hour. And when she hung up the phone, she said, "You know what? I think they're going to get married." And it was their first date. Okay, so this shows, and a year later they were married, and year and a half after that, Evelyn came along. So Evelyn owes her life to Facebook. I mean, Evelyn would not be here without Facebook. She's back in Michigan. But actually, that's the bad point, is that she now lives in Michigan with her parents. She's lived in Michigan, which is 9 hours away from us by car. And her dad went to seminary, so I guess the whole, you know, theology thing wasn't a pickup line. It was just, it was the real deal. Anyway, because of an invention that's an awful lot like the Jetsons. How many of you remember the Jetsons? Yeah, okay. You remember Mr. Spacely showing up on the video screen and, you know, at the most inopportune moments? Well, this actually was an opportune moment from yesterday. Evelyn and this is, yeah, that was me really early, yeah. But with Evelyn and her brother Judah. They live in Michigan, and what's really neat is I see them more often than my parents saw my kids growing up, and we were only 100 miles away, and they're, you know, like 600-700 miles from us. And this, by the way, also is our third grandchild, Aletta. So she was born in August. So here's the fourth reason. The first three were personal reasons. Why, if I can do this, you can do this. This is the fourth reason. If Mayo Clinic can do this, you guys can do this. In the U.S., in Mayo Clinic, we have some brand research that we do with consumers, and we essentially ask them, and I'm paraphrasing a bit, if you're really, really sick and money is no object, where would you want to go for diagnosis and treatment? And Mayo Clinic comes up at number one. When I was oriented at Mayo Clinic into my public relations job, one of the things they told me is they showed me data like this, and they said, your first job is to not screw this up, okay? We got this great thing going, and don't mess with it. And so you might imagine that an organization like Mayo with a lot to lose would have some, you know, nervousness about being engaged in a platform, in platforms like this, and you'd be right. Because there's nobody as risk-averse and uptight as Mayo Clinic. Okay, we're there with you. So if we can do this as an organization, if we can get past some of the concerns, so can you. So now I want to tell you a little bit of the history of how we got into social media at Mayo Clinic. It started when I worked at in public relations. We began this program called Mayo Clinic Medical Edge in April of 2000. Which was a weekly 90-second news package for TV stations in the U.S. and Canada to help supplement their news coverage and provide them trustworthy, reliable information. We followed that up in 2004 with a daily 60-second radio segment. When I heard about podcasting in 2005, I heard, well, that's just an RSS feed that lets you subscribe to audio files. I said, we already have audio files on our website. So using the proceed until apprehended model of innovation, I said, let's just create a podcast. And so we got somebody to make an RSS feed for us. We listed it in the iTunes podcast directory, which was a month old at the time. So it was kind of being at the right place at the right time, you know, with a big brand. The month before we started our podcast, we got featured on the front page for 3 weeks. Okay, that was kind of a big thing. The month before we did our podcast, we had 900 downloads of our MP3 files. The month after our podcast, we had 74,000, or an 8,200% increase. That was really helpful for us to get the attention internally that there's something to this, that this isn't just that there'd be an interest, there'd be an appetite. Because there certainly was among some of our leadership, well, why don't we just focus on the big media, like the New York Times and, you know, Wall Street Journal, others like that. This helped us make the argument that we should look at this more closely. And so we stepped back a little bit, and we said, instead of just having the hypochondriac feed, you know, sort of the 60-second, you know, disease of the day thing, how about if we create podcasts that more fit the medium, okay? Because the analogy we used was genomics, that, you know, genomics is to mass media as social media is to mainstream media. So the mainstream media and mainstream medicine, broad-based medicine, are all really important, and they're not supplanted by this. But there's an opportunity to personalize media, just as genomics means personalized medicine. We specifically at the time, though, said we didn't want to do blogging. We said, let's figure out how we can change our process a little bit. But we didn't want to blog because we didn't want to take doctors away from treating patients to wordsmith blog posts. We also didn't want to ghostwrite for them because we wanted it to be authentic. And so just in a concern of not knowing how big this was going to be, we just didn't want to get into that at first. So we said, let's reform our processes first. And so, but I did, however, personally start my own blog. I called it Lines from Lee. Pretty clever, right? You know. Anyway, I didn't know what it was going to be about, but I just knew I wanted to get that experience personally. So at the time that I started my blog, according to Technorati, there were 50 million of us publishing regularly to the web. So as we started to execute that first strategy, that phase one strategy, we said, we're interviewing doc, let's create categories. So let's do a heart podcast, a cancer podcast, and instead of, well, okay, so here's an example, first of all. When we'd interview doctors, we typically do like a 20-minute interview, and it'd be about this much that would show up on the air actually from the doctor. And actually, you don't need to hear the audio because mainly the thing is, what's the length of this? It's about 8 seconds. Okay, so you interview the doctor for 25 minutes for a 90-second package that has an 8-second soundbite. What we were able to do in this case, this was Dr. Phil Fisher talking about POTS syndrome, postural orthostatic tachycardia syndrome. which affects primarily young girls. Something in their nervous system triggers as adolescents, and they go, they have something happen where they now go, when they go from laying down to standing up, their heart races, you know, 20, 30 beats a minute faster, their blood pools in their arms and legs, they feel icky and fatigued and some maybe even throwing up. And they go to their local doctor who says, you're a teenager, you're under a lot of stress. You should just, or maybe you need to just get counseling. There's nothing wrong with you. This is a condition that, you know, can be treated by beta blockers and some other, you know, dietary changes, and it can be managed. Anyway, what we did in this case was we took a 20-minute interview down to about a 22-minute podcast, because we put a microphone on both the doctor and the interviewer. So instead of having 99%+ of it go to waste, or at least, I mean, it was all used to inform the TV piece, we're able to give that in-depth information to parents and family members of kids that, and the kids who have this. So in this case, this particular post on our podcast blog got 60,000 hits. And shortly thereafter, we had a gentleman by the name of Shell Holtz come in as a consultant for us, and he did the salutary, provided the salutary service of certifying that I wasn't crazy, you know, which was kind of the you know, to have somebody from outside say that this is okay to do. Just after that, or actually 6 months after that, we did our first blog. Now, we were concerned before about blogs maybe going stale and not having content. This microphone doesn't seem, and not having enough content. But in this case, we had a conference going. It was a day and a half, and we said, what if we just do a blog during the conference that doesn't have any expectation of long-term maintenance? And so that was our chance to get experience with us on behalf of Mayo. Shortly thereafter, we discovered that we were on social media. We were in social networking, whether we liked it or not. Well, this wasn't really us. This is a rock band in from the UK that goes by the name Mayo Clinic. And we pretty much like that brand imagery. I mean, we're pretty excited about that. And actually, it gets even a little bit worse. But they're not good. But we couldn't take it away, because they actually were a rock band that went by the name Mayo Clinic. But the positive side of that is that when Facebook made pages available to organizations, where I was able to go to my department chair and say, I want that same thing to happen on Facebook that happened on MySpace. And sure enough, we got same-day approval for it. A pivotal presentation for me was one that I made for the Association Forum of Chicagoland in December of 2007. They asked me to do a Facebook 101 course, 20 minutes on Facebook repeated 4 times. And I got some kind of in-depth questions, and I thought, I just offhand said, well, that's in the 201 class, which got me to thinking I had a chance to rebrand my blog so that instead of, you know, lines from Lee and this whole kitchen sink thing, I renamed it Social Media University Global, or SMUG. And I named myself the chancellor, as you see down there. You know, when you create a university, you can give yourself a great title. But our Latin school motto there means it's not that hard. And my whole point with this is, and part of my mission is to help mid-career professionals understand these tools and how they can be used in their work. So this is our main campus building in Austin, Minnesota. We call that Old Main. But we've got the oak-shrouded campus with ivy-covered walls. We've got your basic core curriculum courses that can take you step by step through learning all these tools. This is our podcasting curriculum, and this is where you go to join. This is our SMUG Facebook group. We call our student body the Smuggles. Like in the Harry Potter books, the Muggles are the ordinary people with no magical abilities. Smuggles are just ordinary people who use magical tools. And what's interesting is we've got around 1,300 people on 6 continents that are part of that Smuggle student body. And this is the first time that I've actually gotten to visit the continent of Australia, so I'm excited about that. But a couple months ago, I got to speak at Medicine 2.0 at Stanford, which got me to thinking, let's do a comparison between SMUG and Stanford. Now, our tuition is way lower. Where they only admit 7% of applicants, we admit anybody. Okay, so we're not selective. You don't have to take any standardized tests to get to be part of this. Our students don't have any debt. We don't know who our distinguished alumni will be yet, but Stanford obviously has us there. But they graduate 95% of their students. We don't graduate anybody because you never graduate from this. You're always learning. So our second consultant that came in was Andy Cernovitz, and he gave us this kind of the money quote here. We had some concern about whether an organization like Mayo should be involved in, so should be on YouTube, because that's where all the skateboarding squirrels and stuff are. I mean, is that really the serious place that we should be? But, you know, he said, YouTube is the second most used search engine in the world, more used than Yahoo, more used than Bing, more used than any of those others, except for Google. And by the way, Google owns YouTube. And so he just said, if you want to be where the people are, you need to be there. So that got us the chance to get our YouTube channel. Somebody else had set up a YouTube channel using Mayo Clinic's name, and we got it back, and we're able to customize it to make it look like us. We also then joined the Blog Council, which is was Andy Cernovitz had set up to help large organizations learn how to use these tools. So it's across industries, and Kaiser Permanente and Mayo are the only healthcare members. But this was a chance for us to learn, and that's actually when we talk about the social media health network. We pretty much plagiarized the model for that, but with the idea of making it not just for big organizations, but then also focused on health and healthcare. In April 2008, we started our podcast blog. We now had enough content where we said we don't need to worry about it going stale. So we put the individual segments out there for people to find. We got on Twitter 3.5 years ago, partly from the defensive reasons to keep British rock bands from claiming it or whatever. And then one of the really important milestones for us was when I went to one of those blog council meetings, and we had been having some discussion about whether it would be okay for Mayo Clinic to use a flip camera, the flip video camera. And there was some controversy, especially among the video purists at Mayo Clinic. You know, we have people who are really good at video, and they're saying you should not use a $150 video camera on behalf of Mayo Clinic. Well, I went to one of the blog council meetings, and I found out that Adam Brown, my colleague from Coca-Cola, was using the flip video camera to video blog the Beijing Olympics. And so then I was able to kind of say, Coca-Cola, kind of a big brand, you know, sort of a big organization and fussy. And, you know, if they're using this, you know, probably we can too. And so as you see here on our YouTube channel, at the point that I took the screenshot, we had 1,150 videos on our YouTube channel. That's because we're able to use tools like this to do quick capture instead of having to hire, you know, a freelance videographer at maybe $700 a day or $700 a half day to go shoot these. We wouldn't have a third of that many videos if we were not able to use this. But because of this, we can go get patient stories, we can highlight research work, and that's made all the difference in the world for us, and particularly in our news blog. Okay, we had also said we don't want to take doctors away from writing things, but if we can interview a doctor for 10 or 15 minutes, and then they don't have to do anything more with it, we're just doing the editing, it's a much better thing. So we use this as our online newsroom where and again, my background is media relations, how to use these tools to do your job better. We put the audio and video files up there for journalists to see, password protected, so it was only for them. This is our first great example of it. Dr. Victor Montori had a study that was coming out in JAMA, the Journal of the American Medical Association. It was coming off embargo at 3 p.m. on Tuesday. I found out about it at 9 a.m. That morning, that very morning, so I had 6 hours. And ordinarily, in the old days, we would have said, I guess we missed that. You know, there wasn't any time to write a news release. And so, but I had the flip camera, we had our news blog, and I was able to post this on our blog. And the next day, the Wall Street Journal Health blog embedded our video in their story. That was really helpful for us with our media relations staff, because they were saying, get me one of those. Okay, I want to take that. And it's helpful for them in just in the process is that you can actually have a conversation with the physician instead of furiously scribbling notes and did I make sure that I got it right. You put the camera on a tripod, and it wasn't like we sent out another person to do the interview. We said, as you're going along, take this camera with you, capture that too, and then we had a limited number of people within our staff who were able to do the editing. We started using these tools for internal communications too. This is our Let's Talk site about our Mayo Clinic strategic plan, a way to help employees think about how the strategic plan initiatives fit for them. This is our culture blog, our Sharing Mayo Clinic blog, where we tell patient stories with appropriate consents, but then also physician stories about their experiences. This is one about Dr. Mike Ackerman, who is a pediatric cardiology fellow, and he was taking care of a little girl from Michigan. Stephanie was going in for a heart transplant, and Stephanie said, "Dr. Mike, am I going to live?" And he said, "Of course you're going to live. In fact, I'm going to dance with you at your prom." And this is the story of 10 years later when he surprised her at her prom. And I don't know why they couldn't have had a flip camera with them. Would that have been so hard? But they but they did get a nice picture. And you see that Stephanie was overcome, as I kind of am even now. But that led to Dr. Mike and Stephanie and her parents being flown out to be on national TV, you know, because we had a place to tell a story like this. And this is the kind of story that needs to be told about the going above and beyond kind of caring. We started also then, just recently, we've created a patient video guide site as a way. This is to improve our practice as we get thousands of patients each year coming for the first time. It's a little different experience at Mayo Clinic, and this is video orientation for them on a website. And then this is our network community for the Social Media Health Network. We're using this to manage. And then finally, our Mayo Clinic Connect site. This is for patients and prospective patients who want to connect and learn from each other and mutually support each other. We have about 10,000 members that have joined since July. Now, I want to step back and take a little broader historical perspective. And to do that, I'll go back to October 31st, 1517, 494 years ago. There was an Augustinian monk named Martin Luther who decided he wanted to start a little conversation with the clerics in town. You know, so he wrote these in Latin. He wrote what he called the Disputation of Dr. Martin Luther on the Power and Efficacy of Indulgences. Because it was in Latin, nailed to the church door, it was meant to be, again, amongst the clerics to discuss. But because of a technological invention of a few decades earlier, the Gutenberg movable type printing press, his was the first viral communications, massively viral, translated from the Latin into German, spread throughout Germany in 2 weeks, spread throughout Europe in 2 months. And it said so on Wikipedia, so I know that must be true. I decided to follow up with that 492 years later with my disputation on the power and efficacy of social media. So this is part of the leading the revolution thing. It's all about starting an argument, or at least starting a discussion, and providing support for those who are saying why we should be using these tools. Also, you know, encouragement, giving them arguments to be able to use in making that case. So I do have a PDF version of the 35 theses. Invite you to download that and nail that to your office door at your own risk. I want to go through 11 of the theses in the remaining time that we have. The first, and this is what really helped us make the argument at Mayo Clinic, I didn't put it in exactly these terms, but social media really aren't new. I mean, the first social medium was air, so sound waves moving through air was the first social medium. Medium is a means by which something's communicated or expressed, and actually Dr. Will and Dr. Charlie Mayo were a Mayo Clinic's first social networkers from a couple perspectives. First, they invented Dr. Henry Plummer invented the unified medical record for patients, because until that time, even if you had a group practice, well, they actually invented the group practice of medicine too. But when they, doctors used to have their own notes about their patients, and it was the doctor's notes. Well, what through Dr. Plummer, they developed the unified medical record, which became the patient's record. So it was a complete paradigm shift, that it's not about the doctors and their notes, it's about the patients and their records, so that the doctors could learn from each other, so that they'd share their observations, and one would build upon another. And so the medical record was the first social networking tool. But from the other sense, externally, Dr. Will would stay home and Dr. Charlie would travel around the world to teach and learn, and then they'd switch places. So one would stay home to mind the practice and the others would be reaching out, and they were from a community, and Carolyn can vouch for this. It's not a large community today. You know, it's a community of about 80,000 people in southern Minnesota, but they didn't let that stop them from reaching out. And even though they had to travel by train and boat, now the argument we're making is that these electronic tools make those connections much more vibrant and much faster. Word of mouth has been important for Mayo Clinic for a long time as well. I mean, it's been the primary way that people find out about us. In fact, as we look in our brand research, what's the reason for your preference for Mayo Clinic? Stories in the news media is number one, or excuse me, word of mouth is number one, stories in the news media is number two. And the power of social media is that it combines that broad reach of media with the power of the personal recommendation. So my second thesis is that the electronic tools just help the word of mouth spread farther and faster. So when Shannon Swing writes on our Mayo Clinic Facebook wall, July 24th, 2008, leiomyosarcoma tumor removal, thanks for saving my life, mom of four in Wisconsin. You know, it's great that, you know, 800 million people on Facebook could see that, but what's more important is that her friends see it. You know, it shows up in the news feed that Carolyn wrote on Mayo Clinic's wall. And I'm not thinking it makes them say, hey, let's go get a colonoscopy at Mayo Clinic. It's not like a demand generation sort of thing. But it's more of putting us in their consideration set, that if they ever come to a time when they need a second opinion, a third opinion, that they might consider us. The fourth thesis is that when you get down to it, social media really are the defining communications trend of the third millennium, or at least the part we'll be around for. Gutenberg owned the 1500s to the 1900s with the printing press. So if you had a printing press, a descendant of Gutenberg, you could communicate broadly. Marconi, who invented radio, owned the 20th century, so radio and TV. Now, TV didn't kill print, and TV didn't kill radio, and social media isn't going to kill the other media. But if you look at what defines our era, it's the fact that anybody can communicate to the world. Okay? So when I originally did this slide, I meant it kind of as a play on words, because Gutenberg and Zuckerberg kind of rhyme. But, you know, Gutenberg made mass literacy possible. It didn't make sense to teach people to read when there's nothing to read. You know, he made mass literacy possible because there was cheap and plentiful reading material. Mark Zuckerberg maybe didn't make mass publishing possible, but he made it reality. Because when I started my blog, I was one of 50 million people publishing to the web, and now there are 16 times that many. Yeah, 16 times that many, 800 million people publishing on Facebook alone. So this is a video that I invite you to check out if you haven't seen it, Social Media Revolution. It's been updated, so if you just Google the term Social Media Revolution, you'll kind of see, you know, a bunch of statistics about all the difference that social media is making. I don't want to show you the whole thing, but mainly, actually, that's really all you need to know. Right there. So, that leads to the seventh thesis, that hand-wringing about this isn't particularly productive because it's just reality. I mean, this is the way things are going. So, now in the UK, there was this story just this summer about how half of employees are banned from Facebook during work hours. How many of you are at a place where employees, regular employees, are blocked from Facebook or YouTube or Twitter and all that? Okay. So for anybody who thinks that's a valid long-term option, I'd just like to introduce you to the iPhone. The reality is that increasingly 24/7 people are going to have access to the web and particularly to these social sites. And so the implication of that is you already have all the risk. Why not get some of the benefits too? Okay? These tools do have powerful benefits. We're going to get into some of those benefits in just a little bit. But we've said we know that our employees are going to be on social media. Let's give them guidelines. Let's develop. So these are our guidelines for Mayo Clinic employees, published out on the web for anybody to plagiarize or use however they'd like. We've also done a video for training of residents. We worked with Dr. Brian Vardabedian, not on our advisory board, maybe will be sometime soon. But he had this idea that you've got these medical residents starting training. We should do a video where we have experienced doctors who are using social media, giving them guidance in how to act appropriately and professionally. So we manage these. We are going to get into some serious applications for these tools, but this one is more of a wow, gee whiz kind of fun thing. I was alerted to a video of Fran and Marlo Cowan. Marlo was 89, his wife Fran was 83. Playing the piano in our Gonda building out in the atrium. We've got a $50,000 Bösendorfer piano given by a benefactor. And there's a sign on that says, if you'd like to play this piano, if you think other people would enjoy hearing you, you know, please feel free to play. Another patient captured them on video and uploaded it to her YouTube channel. I found out about it about 6 months later, and at that time there had been 1,000 views of this video. I put it on our blog, I put it on Facebook, and tweeted it out, and the next day it was up to 3,800 views. By 6 days later, it's at 27,000. By April 22nd, it's at 65,000 views. May 3rd, it was 188,000 views. That was kind of a red letter day for me personally, because that's when it was featured in Random Lunatic News, which is something I, you know, I've sort of always aspired to. So with the one sentence post, this will just make you stupidly happy. It was also on FARC.com that same day, given the cool tag, because there's no awesome tag. But then by May 4th, it's at 228,000 views. By May 10th, at 555,000 views. And we had been in touch with Mr. and Mrs. Cowan. Then they lived in a suburb of Des Moines, Iowa. We said, would you be okay if we pitched your story to news media? They said that'd be fine. And so we did. And this is the Des Moines Register, their local paper, where they had this big online story as well as front page. And they interviewed them in their home. And you see Mr. Cowan saying, what tube? Because he was 90 years old now and had only seen the video on somebody else's iPhone. But the next day, they're at 608,000 views. They crossed the million mark on May 15th. They crossed the 2 million mark on May 26th. And that was when they were live in the studio in Good Morning America. And so for any of you who haven't seen this, I want to take the next minute 15 to make you stupidly happy. So I stayed in touch with Mr. and Mrs. Cowan, and when they were coming back for an appointment, their daughter sent me an email, said, would you want to schedule a concert with them? And so we did, and we captured that on my flip camera, put it on our YouTube channel, posted that on our blog. A Japanese-American blogger saw it, who lives in San Diego, and that led to NHK Television in Japan seeing it, calling and wanting to interview them and do a story by Skype. And so here's a bit of that interview.
So there, 投稿者を通じてお二人に連絡を取りお話を聞きました。
We didn't even know we were on YouTube.
No, we didn't know what YouTube even was.
We didn't know what the word meant.
No.
So we
we're still not sure.
今年2月、あの病院に多くの観衆や報道陣が集まりました。動画によって世界的に有名になった夫婦のコンサート。
But the results on this, more than 7.7 million views, 1.5 million of those on our blog, okay? And so that isn't exactly hardcore research or anything like that, but it's making people smile when they think about us, which is not a bad thing, but also then connecting them with our blog and other resources that we have available. So number 11, social media strategies can help make a product or service better, and this is where we're starting to get into some of the practical applications. Dr. Sri Koka is our chair of prosthodontics, and we have a history at Mayo Clinic, and one of the things we're really known for, part of that word of mouth, is people come to Mayo Clinic, and the first appointment, you get an hour, okay? You get an hour to talk with the doctor and tell your story and take a complete medical history, and it's an unhurried, thorough time. And increasingly, we're under pressure, though, because you want to see more patients. You need to see more patients for economic reasons. And one of the concerns is that, you know, are we going to lose something of what we're known for if we're, you know, trying to crank down on that or trying to, you know, see more patients? So Dr. Koka had realized that when he sees a new patient, for the first 10 minutes, a lot of the conversation is the same, whether they're talking with Dot, his assistant, or talking with him. For one thing they say is, he's got kind of a funny name. Where's he from? You know, where did he study? You know, they want to know his background. But then secondly, he also realized that one of the things that's frustrating as a clinician is when patients aren't prepared to be good patients. Okay, they don't really know how to explain what it is they need. And so he did this video where he took the first bit to introduce himself and for Dot to introduce herself, and then to say, people who come to me are looking for one of three things. They're needing help with their bite, you know, with the function, they're having pain, or they're worried about cosmetics. And if you can think about which of those is most important to you as we're getting ready to meet, that'll help me better serve you. Okay. So our goal with this, and we're going to study it, we're going to say, how does this affect patient satisfaction? What he does say is, he sent it, you know, it's like 1,200 people that have seen it so far. He does send it to the patients, and he says, I can tell when they've seen it. I can tell when they've watched the video because they feel like they know me a little. They look at me differently. And hopefully what we'll see with that is whether it closes the gap or whether it makes the appointments able to be shorter or not, it's building a rapport and building trust with the physician before the patient even gets there. I saw an opportunity with this, and this is the next thesis, that these are tools that can help us be a lot more productive. As we're recruiting for the social media health network, you know, the dues are, you know, some multiple of $1,000, you know, and so it's not the kind of thing that somebody writes a check for, you know, just without, because they saw it on a website. They need to talk to somebody. So we're scheduling calls, and I talked to about 90 people about it, and I realized I'm saying the same thing over and over a lot. So what if I did a video to introduce the network, and then I could send that out in advance of the phone call, and maybe we could make the phone calls be more effective. So we did that. I was averaging 30 minutes a call before this. We took 60 minutes to do a video production, you know, using a flip camera just to describe what we're doing. Even though it's a 6-minute video, it saves about 10 minutes a call because I can just send it out there. And for one thing, I did it kind of right the one time. But then I can just say, here's what this is about. Did you have questions? Or we can talk more about the other person, the other organization and their needs. So given that I've made 90 calls since that point, total minutes saved are 900, or ROI at 1,400%. You know, and that's common denominator. It's my time is the common thing involved in there. So I got to believe there's some ways that you can use tools like that within your work, too. Social media are free in any ordinary sense of the word. I did some cost calculations of our Facebook, YouTube, and Twitter all together, and this is what we're paying for them. I was in Europe last year, and based on current exchange rates, at least, that phenomenon is the same there, too. And also then here in Sydney, I found out that it's a global phenomenon. It's free. That leads to the 18th thesis, as if you keep the eye really small, ROI gets really big, okay? So you don't have to have as much payback if you can keep the cost low. So this is Dr. Ruben Mesa. He's a blood cancer specialist at Mayo Clinic. He did this 10.5-minute video on myelofibrosis. That it's not 7.7 million views, but it's about 10,200 views. It's the right 10,200 people. It's either patients or their family members. In fact, this is the video, the email that he sent me a year and a half ago that says, there's hardly a new out-of-state consult I see that doesn't mention these videos. He'd say at least 50 that have come because of this video that we shot with a $150 video camera and put on our free YouTube channel and then embedded in our blog that we pay about $6 a month for. So I realize you have different models, you know, different reimbursement models than what we have in the United States. But from this perspective, this is helping him, you know, even if you're just trying to build a subspecialty practice where you want to see a lot of patients who have similar conditions so that you can get better at that, there's some perspective there too. Thesis 21, the technology makes things possible, people make things happen. And I want to illustrate with the story of spontaneous coronary artery dissection, just call attention to that highly dignified author, distinguished author in the middle of this paper in Mayo Clinic Proceedings. Here's a bit about what spontaneous coronary dissection is.
This is what happens during a spontaneous coronary artery dissection. A tear develops in the inside of a coronary artery, allowing blood to create a split between two layers of the wall. This may result in a loose flap of tissue on the inside of the artery. The flap, or a blood clot that forms in the damaged artery, can block blood flow and potentially cause a heart attack.
Spontaneous coronary artery dissection happens to more women than men, generally around childbearing age, okay? And Catherine Leon was one of those. She was 38 years old when she had her second child, And she went to the doctor saying, I'm just feeling fatigued and icky and rotten. And her doctor said, of course you're feeling fatigued. You just had your second child. But the pain got worse, and she ended up having gripping chest pain, went to the hospital, and had a heart attack, had bypass surgery. And when she went to her doctor afterwards, he said, do you realize how lucky you are to be alive? I mean, about 50% of the people die from this. And she said, am I more likely to have it again? I mean, because I've had one, am I more likely to have it again? And he said, we don't know. I mean, the largest case series that we've had that's been reported in the scientific literature is 47 people. And so Catherine felt like she was sitting on a time bomb. That's what she said. I literally felt like I was sitting on a time bomb. So she went online. She connected with a group called Women Heart. They had a website, and she did a post. All the SCAD ladies, put your hands up. And she gathered 60 women who had had a spontaneous coronary artery dissection, including Laura Haywood Corey. And they went to a Women Heart conference sponsored by Mayo Clinic and hosted by Sharon Hayes, who is with our Women's Heart Clinic. And they came to her and they said, would you like to study us? I mean, we've got this group of 60 women all together. Would you like to study us? And Dr. Hayes said, that sounds really interesting, and went and got IRB, Institutional Review Board, approval for a pilot study to see what if we created a virtual registry. You know, nobody sees enough of these patients to really study them thoroughly, but what if we did a virtual registry? And they got approval for that. At that point, Catherine went online and just posted the link to the study, or posted information about the study on the Women Heart group. And within a week, we had 18 people signing up for the 12-person study. So it never even actually got on our website, because this Women Heart group gathered the people already. Now, that wasn't the hard part. The hard part was to say, and the real reason for the study was to say, can you gather the medical records from all these diverse audiences? Like, well, it ended up that within 6 months, they had one person from New Zealand, one from the UK, two from Canada, and the rest from the United States that had submitted their records. And so the pilot had been, and they told the others, wait, you know, we'll see if we can extend the study. Pilot was a success. It led to that publication in Mayo Clinic Proceedings. And now we've got a 200-person study that's about 100 people recruited so far, or have expressed interest in being part of it, all made possible because of Catherine. Okay, this has turned research completely on its head. Instead of just being investigator-initiated, patients were able to mobilize to help make it happen. Thesis 33, social media will reduce the diffusion time for research and innovation. Dennis Cortez was our CEO, and one of the things he used to complain about a lot was how it takes about 17 years from research discovery to this thing working the way through the system. And patients suffer needlessly during that time because we don't all know what we all know. This is an example of how that can change. Richard Berger is an orthopedic surgeon at Mayo Clinic. He discovered a kind of tear of a ligament in the wrist, in this ligament, that instead of being a pulling apart, a complete rupturing, it's a lengthwise split, kind of like a celery stick, or as he says, like a Polish sausage bursting on the grill. Maybe that's a cultural thing that isn't going to fit here. But at any rate, because the ends are still joined, on an MRI it doesn't look that different, and so it's missed. He did also then discover how you fix this. You scoop out the inflammation, stitch it up, and after 6 weeks in a cast, 95% of patients are back to normal. The bad news is if you don't have this operation and you have this injury, you never get any better. Cortisone doesn't do anything, rest doesn't do anything. So he was studying this over the next 4 or 5 years with patients who are coming to Mayo Clinic, and he thinks it's probably as common as an ACL tear, but it's just that nobody recognizes it, nobody sees it. About that time, as he was getting ready to start publishing in the medical journals, there was a baseball player by the name of Jason Wirth who was hit by a pitch in spring training, and over the next 18 months was on an ordeal, you know, going from specialist to specialist to try to figure out what was wrong. He was not able to swing without pain. And so by 18 months after that, by August of 2006, he thought he was done. He thought he was out of baseball. When a family friend met him at the mailbox and said, you ought to go see Dick Berger at Mayo Clinic and just see if he has anything to offer. Dr. Berger had also discovered how you diagnose this. The high-tech stuff doesn't work so well, but if you push really hard right here, if your knees buckle and you scream, you know, you've got it. It's like 95% sensitive and specific. And I'm not sure what Jason's response was exactly, but he did have a positive result to that test and had the operation. And 3 months later, he signed an $850,000 contract as an extra outfielder with the Philadelphia Phillies. Fast forwarding 2 years, he's playing in the World Series. And I'm a PR guy, and I'm thinking, what a great story. I got to tell this. And so we were trying to pitch it to journalists, and for some reason I couldn't get them to pick up on it. I might have started too late, might not have been very persuasive, but we got no pickup. A few months later, I was in Philadelphia. The Phillies were in Philadelphia. I had my flip camera with me. I called the Phillies and got permission to go interview Jason. He was delighted to do that. So we got him on our YouTube channel. We put it on our Sharing Mail Clinic blog, and I felt at least we got the story out there somehow. A few months later, he hits a couple home runs to send them to the second World Series. Not asleep at the switch this time. We got it posted on our news blog with the transcript, including the link to the videos. It led to some print coverage, as well as the TV station actually taking our video from YouTube that was shot with a flip camera and putting it on over the air. But the big thing was that USA Today did this story in the health section as a way of calling attention to this really not well understood, even among medical professionals, kind of cause for chronic wrist pain. We discussed with the editors, what if we did a Twitter chat with Dr. Berger? What if we let him talk online with your readers? And so they agreed to do that. We used the wrist pain hashtag that same day, announced in the newspaper that for readers that they could be part of this. Three, 4 months later, I saw this blog post from a woman named Erin Turner from Washington, D.C. The first line of her post is, when I arrived at Mayo Clinic in Rochester a few weeks ago, I was asked, who referred you to us? My answer was not traditional, Twitter. She had been part of that. She had been part of that Twitter chat. She ended up she'd had this problem for 5 years. She's 28 years old. She couldn't open a spaghetti sauce jar, okay? And she was looking at 5 decades of that never going away. But this is what she said in her blog post. Now I have a chance at a future without chronic wrist pain that, without those in the medical community willing to experiment with new communications tools, might not exist for me. The follow-up to this is the Phillies opened their season in Washington, D.C., where Erin lived. We arranged for Erin to get to meet with Jason to say thanks, and coincidentally, USA Today was there as well. And they were able to compare scars and share their stories. And this is what Dr. Berger had to say to me by email just after that. He said, the tide shifting with this, I presented a plenary session to the American Society for Surgery of the Hand. Lots of surgeons are adopting this. Social media has driven this into practice in less than 2 years when it takes 17 years on average. I'll let you read the rest of that for yourself. But anyway, the follow-up on this is that Jason signed the 13th richest contract in Major League Baseball history last December, $18 million a year for 7 years. We're thinking that a Richard Berger Center for Surgery of the Hand would be a good response to that. But then this is the story that was in the New York Times when he started the season. The second paragraph is about his experience at Mayo Clinic. So the upshot of this is that he's seeing about twice as many patients with this condition that are coming pre-selected to have this kind of surgery. But secondly, he's been able to draw attention to the condition that people that he's trained all over the country are able to provide this as well as other surgeons. Thesis 35, social technologies will transform healthcare. I told you about POTS before. This is a video that we did on POTS, and Dr. Phil Fisher did this about some of his research, 36,000 views of this one. And Haley Lairmore was a young girl. She still is a young girl, but she lives in Lake Arrowhead, California, which is about a mile in the mountains above of Los Angeles. And on her 13th birthday, she went to Disneyland, and when she went home that night, she woke up vomiting. And for the next 6 months was vomiting 10 to 12 times a day, every day. And her mom was taking to her specialists in the hospitals all over Southern California and finally was told, you're never going to get a diagnosis. She's not really sick. She needs counseling. And one night while her daughter was vomiting, she went online on Google and came across a blog post from a young girl who had been a patient of Dr. Fisher's. And her blog post said, I have POTS. I feel, these are my symptoms. But Dr. Fisher's really helped me deal with them. She also then found that video with Dr. Fisher, and she went to her doctor and said, do you think it could be POTS? And the doctor said, POTS isn't even a real thing. It's just a throwaway kind of diagnosis. And she said, really? I mean, this is a Mayo Clinic doctor talking about this. wanting to be, because there was that video, she had the courage to come across the country to get seen by Haley, or to get to have Haley seen by Dr. Fisher. I found out about it through this comment card. I was able then to get Mrs. Lairmore to write a story about Christine's experience on our blog. And when I was in California the following May, I took my flip camera and went to meet Christine, and here's a bit of what she had to say.
First of all, I feel like I have a decent level of an education and intelligence. I mean, you know, I'm a college graduate, but I'm not in the medical field. But a lot of the things you come across are either, you know, too medical jargon, like a lot of sites you come across say you have to have a password to get into, or this is only for doctors, or they're like, they're medical abstracts, or they're just too simplistic, like, you know, for new moms and babies. And I just really lucked into you know, finding the Mayo Clinic website, and I'm not good on the computer, so I think lucky I found that. And it probably never in a million years would have occurred to me to think to go, let's go look at the Mayo Clinic and find out what they have there. And they live there so far away, I never would have thought of looking for a doctor specifically at the Mayo Clinic. I would say be a loudmouth for your kid, be vocal, be an advocate. I mean, I cannot tell you how many times we heard no. So many times. It had to be close to 100 from different doctors, nurses, specialists, clinics, the ER. Who's going to advocate for your child if you don't do it? I mean, Haley could still be in pain if I hadn't lucked into finding Dr. Fisher, but I just wasn't going to give up. There's no way.
At her lowest, Haley was at 76 pounds as a 13-year-old. When I saw her, she's back up in the 90s. She'd had to quit school. She's now back in school, you know, and doing well. And that leads, but we were able to use this story to pitch to news media. The fact that we had this video, this led to ABC TV, actually their online site, using our video to tell the story as well. But the 37th thesis is that applying social media isn't just inevitable, it's the right thing to do on behalf of patients, to give them the help that they need, to help people like Christine, to help people Aaron, you know, with her wrist pain. But I do want to share just one more thing in closing in honor of Steve Jobs. Well, it isn't completely in a sense, yeah, whatever. One thing. I was... So you guys have seen this video. Do you guys know what this is about? What's this video about? It's about breast cancer, okay? It's about breast cancer, obviously, right? You know? Anyway, it's the Pink Love Dance, and I had gotten an email from one of our staff people who works in the Women's Heart Clinic saying, we should do something like this for, you know, heart disease. And as I thought about it, you know, we couldn't do a copycat, because that's just not us, you know, for Mayo Clinic to be dancing, and that's just not going to happen. We also didn't want to be that derivative, okay? It would be fun, it'd be okay to be fun, but it should have a serious educational purpose. And so we decided that going the parody route of a well-known song would be the right way to do it. And so we came up with this story based on 8675309. You guys know this song? You know, Jenny? Okay, so at any rate, this is the whole premise of this song. From back in 1982, is Tommy Two-Tone. He sees Jenny at the bar, gets her phone number, can't work up the gumption to actually call her, and so he's obsessing over her phone number. He's talking to his psychologist, saying, 8675309, Jenny, don't change your number. Anyway, he's peeking outside her window, and actually the psychologist has gone to see Jenny. He used her phone number. Tommy is hauled away by the cops, ends up in the slammer because he's a peeping Tom. So actually, it's kind of a creepy song. But we decided we could try to redeem it, our Know Your Numbers premise related to heart disease. It's 30 years since their first encounter. Tommy's a changed man. He's slowed down a bit. He's no longer obsessed with the phone number, and he drives a minivan. But Jenny hasn't changed her phone number, and so he's calling her to tell her about some more important numbers than her phone numbers. Instead of 8675309, here's the first couple minutes of it.
Jenny, watching it since I first saw you. It's been 3 decades, wow, the time sure flew. And I don't mind saying that I was a creep, and I could not blame you if you hung up on me. But now I've straightened my life out, I'm on the right track. I'm helping Mayo Clinic prevent heart attacks. Although I know there's no chance that you'd be my wife, I wanna tell you some numbers that could save your life. That's why I want you to get this free Facebook app. It makes learning about your heart numbers a snap.
Okay, so please do go check out the rest, but we've developed a campaign that's, this is actually really our first campaign. We've got a YouTube video, a Facebook application with calculators so people can do their heart disease risk or heart attack risk, body mass index, LDL cholesterol, and then we have a contest site to help promote development of this. This is our Facebook app that we put on our Mayo Clinic Facebook page, and then the contest site. I just wanted to introduce you to that and then say, here's where we can interact further, but we're going to interact further in a little bit as soon as Melissa and Hugh are done. But